The full driving review of the Škoda Kodiaq, the new big SUV from Škoda, that is today on Autogefühl, your number one resource for in-depth car reviews and your number one community to discuss cars with Thomas. We're going to take a detailed look on the exterior, different color choices, interior, different trims and what you need to buy there, and also take a look at the driving, of course, today with all of the features, DCC and whatever there is to offer, assistance systems and so on. So everything you really need to know about the new Škoda Kodiaq, I can promise you it will get very interesting and also very beautiful here in the beautiful landscape of Majorca. So relax, sit back and enjoy Autogefühl in full HD, full screen and full length. Let's go! Starting with the front grille, we got this very characteristic Škoda front grille with vertical fins. Then the logo placed very prominently, and there was one question of you guys, because it seemed like it would be fixed with a screw. No, it's not. It's just as usual with glue. And screws in front of the logo, for example, would also be forbidden for crash safety reasons. Very interesting is also that we got this somehow kind of power dome seat right here, those design lines, and those also make a very strong front. This is the front camera we can also see here, by the way, and this is also the top trim level style, therefore we also got a little stronger lower bumper. And overall, well, it's not the most aggressive look, because you see we got the rather round shape in the front here, so this car also does not want to be too aggressive in the front. Those headlights are optional in LED, as we see it right now. And then you see there is what designers claim to be inspired by a Czech glass handcraft. You got the 3D effect and also this work inside. So overall, a very interesting detail. 4.70 meters or 15'4" is the total length of this vehicle. And let me tell you, where is it exactly inside the Volkswagen Corporation? Also, if you consider, for example, a Seat Ateca, a Volkswagen Tiguan, a Volkswagen Tiguan XL, and also a new Volkswagen Atlas. Well, the Seat Ateca is the shortest one. Then this one here is already bigger than the Tiguan. So it goes Ateca, normal Tiguan, Škoda Kodiaq, and this Škoda Kodiaq with a wheelbase of 280 in meters will have the same wheelbase as the Tiguan XL. If it will be named like this, this one will be the Volkswagen Tiguan available for the US, Canadian and also, for example, the Chinese market. So those two will be pretty much alike, but we'll also show you all of the differences, of course. So this one here, about 11 centimeters longer wheelbase than a standard Tiguan. And what can we see in the side profile? Well, this car is more about, quite often seen from Škoda, about form follows function. That means steep window line, we don't lose too much space. Rims start from 17 inch, now here 18 with the higher trim levels. Trim levels go active, ambition, style. This one here is style and connected with 18 inch. 19, so one size bigger, would also be available. The design line is above the door handles, and then it's always what designers describe as play from light and shadow. You can see the different nuances where the light changes from light and shadow, very interesting. Solid door handles we can already see right here. And then the chrome frame here, I think It is rather conservative layout also here in the rear, so not too much playing around with the design. What is remarkable that we got those rather angular wheel arches, so they're not round. That creates a rather crossover SUV look also with the plastic fenders. And I mean, it also has a certain degree of off-road capability for sure. So what do you think about the design in the side profile? And by the way, to name the last sibling, the Volkswagen Atlas, it's a length 5.04 meters, 16'4", and that would be like here, so something more in the rear even. But the interesting thing is, all those cars I've mentioned are from the MQB platform for the compact cars, and therefore they can also have a lot of, you know, positive effects in the production because they can share a lot of parts. That makes all the Skoda Kodiaq relatively affordable. For example, in Germany it starts at 25,000 euros with front wheel drive and also the smallest petrol engine. And the white car you've seen initially, we'll also come to that one again. That one is the standard version and we can also take a look at that one very soon. But first of all, here to our lava blue car, here with the rear lights. And this is very interesting because in the rear they come standard with LED technology and are drawn very horizontally. That's modern style nowadays, and also has some similarities with the Tiguan in the rear for sure if you look at this window line. So what the Skoda doing is not creating too much attention with the design, and that might really work because the customers maybe also don't want a too joyful design with this car. Or what's your opinion on that one? This one here, the 4x4 version, therefore we also have this 4x4 logo here in the rear. And some more color choices, for example here a bright red one. I really like it because it's a strong color and not as many other colors, just, you know, very flat. This one here really stands out, I think. Or what do you think? And from Corrida Red we jump to Jungle Green. This is, as for my personal taste, maybe my least favorite color, but maybe it fits well into your forest, won't it? Or what about a plain white, especially people in Spain, like here, or in other southern European countries, really often pick the white cars. Top selling color, however, will usually be silver, because this one is rather a neutral color and also often pick for fleet customers. And there's also a cappuccino beige. To me it's also kind of gray or silver color, but you know, males are always worse in color choices than females because they see more nuances in colors. What color do you see in there? Do you see a cappuccino? An interesting alternative to brilliant silver might also be to go a little bit darker here in quartz gray. And that you can see our main test vehicle once again in the same light as the other colors we've presented to you right now. This is again our lava blue car, my favorite color. It's not really close to Thomas blue, which would be a little bit brighter, but still I think a very elegant choice, and also with some sparkling effects in the sunlight. And also interesting, we had a Seat Ateca in lava blue, and some people were wondering, ah, is it Mediterranean blue or lava blue? Yes, it was lava blue. And why is that? Well, the Ateca is also built by Skoda, so obviously also offer the lot of same color choices for that. And here, by the way, a choice with 19-inch rims, same lava blue color, but bigger the top available rims right here, and they have special, let's say, hole style with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 holes. So a pretty spectacular setup here, and we also have the LED daytime running lights active right now, that I can see them better. This is the car key, standard car key that is used in the Volkswagen Group. Same with the Tiguan, for example. Also keyless entry available. See, it's just enough to open the car or close it. Then we got this protecting lip. It's for the front and the rear door from rubber, that you don't damage other cars or the car yourself. And you see, no matter how fast you want to do it, it's always working. So, a good solution. We've always seen it with the Ford Focus, for example. Now they have taken it over, and you can get this one as an option, but it's not too expensive. Then this interior in a beige style, bright style, I like that very much. And let's get inside and talk about trim levels. First of all, high seating position as we expect from an SUV, very comfortable, also a good overview. Trim levels start with active, and ambition and style is the highest trim level. That's worldwide pretty much even. All come with fabric on the inside of the seats as a standard. That's really great. And then above that, you can pick fabric on the inside and leatherette on the outside. Also a great combination, but you really have to, you know, dig deep into the prices to know that, or just watch Autogefühl. Because here, you've seen we have here Alcantara on the inside or microfiber. But when you have the Alcantara combination, then they use animal skin on the outside. It's not really necessary, but they do it. And then above that, there's a full animal skin equipment. But at least we have all three trim levels. Even in the high trim level, you get the cloth seats and also this combination cloth inside, leather outside. And from the visual part, maybe the Alcantara one looks more premium. But from how it behaves in summer, I would even tell you to go for the fabric variant, or Stoff in German, on the inside, maybe full or also with the leatherette part on the outside, because that stays a little bit cooler in summer times. Also, Alcantara can, you know, be that cozy that it also gets a little bit hotter then. Here, you know, it's a little bit stickier, so if you're driving sporty, that one keeps you better tight, and the other one, the cloth variant, also lets you slide a little bit more for everyday getting in and out. That's maybe also a little bit handier. Steering wheel, pretty compact. You can set it up in all the ways, and also all a solid construction. Multimedia on the steering wheels, volume, picking up the phone, and also for controlling the inside of the gauges. Instruments, classic analog, left side RPM, right side speed. And in the middle part, you can see consumption, also from GPS or phone information. Here, for example, also a compass. And soon there will also be a fully digital cockpit available for the Kodiaq, but not yet. If you have your trailer assist activated, and here you've got a trailer also behind the car, then you can actually control it like this with the mirror button. You can control where the trailer is going to, and then the steering wheel is adjusted automatically. In a side perspective on the seats, what is interesting is the seat surface is really wide, so also taller people and also bigger people will have plenty of space here. Head room, really plentiful, 1 meter 86, 6 foot one. If you're not subscribed to Autogefühl yet, you're not subscribed yet? Not good. Then here's the electric control of seats in the front. We lift it up in the rear, also the back part of the seats, and also an electric lumbar support. But of course, you'll also be just fine with the manual control. Those ones here are nice because they also have the memory function, so you can save, for example, 1, 2, maximum 3 drivers. Cockpit overview. I will also start the ignition. And at first, it doesn't look that spectacular, but there are a lot of interesting details. For example, dashboard is from soft surface here, so well-built quality. And you see those, well, almost like design lines on the exterior shape are repeated here on the inside. So interesting that we see those design shapes here in a dashboard. And everything flows towards the nude touchscreen, and there are different sizes available. You can either have 6.5 called Swing, or this one here, 8-inch called Bolero, and then you can suit 2 GPS systems to that, Amundsen or Columbus. Columbus is the one with a DVD player in the glove box and also a flash drive. And you can see here proximity sensor, 4 buttons below there. The touchscreen is really interesting. You can see the GPS here with a crystal clear display, and the screen itself feels soft. It's an interesting haptical experience, and also you see the reaction times are superbly fast. That is really one of the best systems I've experienced yet. And there are no more real buttons on the outside. This is all capacitive, so if you want to connect your phone via Bluetooth, you can do it here. Yeah. Or you can also go via USB cable and then Android Auto, Apple CarPlay or Mirror Link, so both ways are possible. Radio, there's also a DAB function, a digital radio, for example, and a general menu. SmartLink is this connectivity feature. Skoda Connect, there are also new online services if you have them. Yeah, loading data. Yeah, we don't have internet connection at the moment, but that would also be possible. So internet features like concierge services. Then just the overview, you can also scroll it like this. So different redundant possibilities. I like it that we can also use the knob, especially while you're driving. That's a useful function. You see 11 liters of consumption with the 1.4 liter TSI. That's a little bit too much. 7 point something is the official figure. You can surely get it to 10 if you're not on serpentine roads. Still, consumption one of the downsides for sure. And then let's see what other green score, vehicle status with a nice visualization, off-road information because this vehicle is also off-road capable. You can see the turning degrees, turning angle of the tires, for example. That is also possible. There's a lot of interesting functions there. And then we also have a rear view camera, which could be in every view. And we could see here, for example, there's a box that is next to the car. I don't see it from here, but I can see it on the camera. And then you have different possibilities for this camera. For example, right here, there's this wide angle view with the area views, you can see even more. And then also from the side, or that way from the side. So a lot of possibilities you have here. And if you just put in the reverse gear, you can also just see the normal rear view camera. That is also possible. But this one here, for example, is also necessary for the trailer assist, which is also available here. You can even change it, adjust the color a little bit. So a lot of possibilities. And for example here, when I start the engine here right now and just put in the reverse gear, at the moment nothing is happening, but if I go back and forth again, this is the normal rear camera. This is a woman, we called her here from Majorca because we're trying to save a cat at the moment also while filming a review. There's a cat that has maybe broken leg. So that's the stuff we also do while reviewing films, trying to save some cats, you know. Sometimes we don't have an easy time. So whole rear view camera or the split view, really interesting things. And also rear traffic ALOT is available. You can get that optionally if you want to park out that you also want for sidely approaching vehicles. AC unit, classic as we know from a Volkswagen Corporation. What is interesting, we got a glossy surface here that makes it even more premium worthy if you keep it clean, so it collects fingerprints quite easily. Also interesting that in between those buttons here, we got those separations that makes it also, you know, more big full-size SUV alike from the worthiness. And this one here is the automatic parking option, so you can have the car park itself. And that's the way you can also activate the trailer assist. We have recently shown you that one also in the Volkswagen Crafter, interesting system. And this one here is the button for the camera, so you can also activate it when going, let's say, in the front in your basement garage. So here you have a small storage space in the front. This could also be a place if you go for the option for the inductive charging, then USB port for your smartphone connection, 12 volt power supply, also illuminated very nicely. And there's this DSG, this thick DSG shifting lever for also 4x4 option here. And I really like it, so it gives another solid feeling. I've never seen it before myself, but I heard it's also available in the Skoda Octavia Scout, but just there. We're going to talk about the different driving modes we have in this vehicle, and there's also off-road mode. This, for example, activates the hill descent control and also sets the stability control on off-road conditions. Storage spaces here inside of the doors, suitable also for bigger bottles. Then below the steering wheel, yeah, I mean, it's not dampened. I think we can live with that. Middle console, first of all, very solid quality. You see it's totally fixed. Then there's a lot of space here in the middle tunnel. However, those beverage holders I'm not really satisfied with. Too wobbly, too small, not high enough. And you can also put them out, and they have a lot of space here. But again, I would prefer better beverage holders. Considering the vast storage spaces everywhere else, the glove box is relatively small, but it can be cooled, for example, for your vegan chocolate bars. And for your sunglasses right here. And that's also space for the SOS button, because they already introduced that you can pick those here to press it for the emergency. And from 2018, those will be mandatory. And this is here the standard fabric seat setup, which is really beautiful in a checkered structure and also with the sides a little bit higher and with contrast stitches. So I would just go with the standard version. Feels very natural as well. It's a very good surface, and you see they've thought a lot about the seat form, and it's very wide as well. And although the Alcantara surface also looks very classy, from seating I found those ones here a little bit cozier, because the Alcantara surface is also a little bit stickier. So here, for example, manual seat, you can slide around in that one a little bit more. It's not really that it's slippery, no, not at all. But I think for everyday driving, a little bit more suitable. Here, the manual seat control, I mean, you cannot do it that well while driving. That's better than with the electric. But overall, I think it's an easy solution, and you can also save some money going with the lower trim. And you will see it very soon if you go for the manual seats. It also has a massive, massive advantage for the co-driver seat. And in this car, Ambition, by the way, the middle trim level, here they have picked another setup for the, you know, for the beauty parts. This one has a style of brushed aluminum. I think it's more beautiful than the one we've seen in the lava blue color inside the car, because it has this very, you know, don't know, distinctive surface. But this one here looks more classy, I think. And you can also see it very well here in the sunlight on the co-driver's side. And this is here the manual shifting stick, and what is really amazing, there's hardly any resistance, totally smooth while shifting. So whereas I do prefer the DSG, I think you can also be just fine with the manual gearbox, as it's really fun and smooth to shift if you want to save some money and go for the basis version, or save the money for the automatic. What about the rear? First of all, see those door protectors, and then, well, the door could open a little bit wider, but then again, we have no problem to get inside because there's really plenty of space here. And wow, this is probably the unique selling point of the Skoda Kodiaq. You know, I'm 1.86 meters or 6'1", and I almost feel lost here in the rear compartment because there's so much space. I'm not sure when I have experienced it in that way. It's more than in any other full-size SUV. We can really say that the space for the rear passengers is superb in a dual way, because it's really like in a Skoda Superb. So there's so much space in front of my knees, although we have this optional foldable table right here. By the way, also with beverage holders on the side, so you can really relax, and also have those iPad holders here. And then headroom is also plentiful. So you sit also relatively high and upright here, and you can also change the rear part of the seat. Well, you could also leave it like this, but let's see where it clicks the first time. There. So you can really have it to a total upright seating position in the rear, and I found that very comfortable. But of course, if you want to sleep, you can also put it a little bit more to the rear. And if you have carefully, for example, watched our world premiere coverage from the Skoda Kodiaq from Berlin, then you've also seen that for the head restraints in the rear, there are also such sleeping devices you can fold up, and then your head is fixed and cannot wobble around. So they've also thought about that, especially, again, of course, for our younger passengers. So this is, by the way, the table, the same in the VW Tiguan, where you have to press the lower part to fold up. It's more stable now, also with the construction, the lower part. In the first generation, the table in the Tiguan was rubbish. Now they've taken the one from the second generation. This one is relatively stable, and also with the beverage holder here. Well, let's not spill any Coke on those beige seats. The rear bench is also slidable, 18 centimeters. You can see it right here. So this would be the maximum trunk setup. And also important, for example, for the seven-seater option, we are going to show you as well. And I mean, that way I could not sit, but if you're maybe shorter, that would work. I could go like this, for example. That already leaves us more trunk, so you're really flexible. We will, however, show you the trunk when the seat setup is like this. And you can then flip the seats from the trunk, or the alternative is also you can do it right from here. And like this, with a strap and the lower part, and then you can fix them. The only disadvantage with this fixation is you cannot fold them up again. You have to reach up over there, pull the strap again, and then you are able to put them up again to the very upright position. You could then also put them back to the rather lower position. And here there's also some more beverage holes on the middle part. Finally, also an iPad holder is available for the attachment here in the front, and for our children again, some more shade in the rear. That's also another clever solution. Easy, don't need any electric stuff right there. So overall, I think one of the best rear compartments we see in the whole automotive industry. Optionally, you can get the three-zone AC also for the rear seats, also with seat heating. And also very clever USB supply, and even a 230 volt supply, real plug in the on the rear to charge things faster. The only thing they didn't really take into account, if you put a MacBook charger in here, for example, from the laptop, that's a little bit too thick, so it should stand out maybe a little more. Let's open the trunk, which belongs with 700 to over 2,000 liters in capacity, to the biggest in its segment. Skoda is famous for that. Electric tailgate is also available. Then you can already see you have a huge entry here, and that would be very important for me if I think about putting my bicycle in there. So that should easily work, even if you have a very long downhill handlebars here. That's no problem. And that's a special thing for you here today, because one of you guys asked me, hey Thomas, can you please measure the trunk with a ruling, with a measuring stick here? And there it is. Let's go. So first of all, look at this cover here. It says press on the top part, which you cannot see at the moment. And it's really so easy. That's the way. And it's a clean and easy solution. And you see it also here. We got those rails on each side. So it's a total clean solution and works really well, even without any electric functions. So please, more of that. It's really great. Then you see the dimensions here. And remember, 1 meter is about 3'2". So the width is here, that's one meter 10, so I would say 3'3". That's already pretty wide. And in the standard setup here of the 5-seater, the length of the trunk is 1.05 meters, so indeed about 3'1", 3'2". Then we also got those hangers here on the side, which you can adjust, and also some interesting function. For example, there's a torch, a small one, which is integrated in the trunk, or you can also take it out separately. And then you can easily flip the seats with those levers of the power supply. You see, they don't really flip here automatically to the very top, to the very bottom part. So you have to press them down. Then you maybe heard that, listen to it again. Then they're really fixed, they don't flip up again. And then we can measure it again. What's the distance then to the back seats? And that is already, wow, I really have to use the whole measuring stick here. It's the famous German Zollstock, as we name it. And so to the driver's seat, as I would be driving, it's almost 2 meters, so 1.90 meters till the lip. So that's about 6'1", 6'2". And that's really amazing. And here we got the electric seat setup. And this leaves us no more option. I could put the co-driver seat a little bit in the front, but that's it. But I can show you what we can do when we don't have the electric seats. So this is our other car setup here with the manual seats and fabric seats. And here, you can fold down the co-driver seat, and that is could be a main reason to go for those lower trim level seats and not for the electric seats, because then you can put long things in here up to a length of 2.80 meters. Let's test that. So I've also removed the trunk cover, and there you can see the maximum space set up all the way to the front. And wow, that's really groundbreaking for this segment. So this is probably the huge selling point for the Skoda Kodiaq. And this one is already 2 meters. So 6'3", 6'4", and then let's see how much more we can get. Yeah, so 2.80 meters. That's, you know, any surfboard could fit in there. And then, by the way, here below the cover, there's also a full replacement tire available. And the child safety test. And you know that a lot of cars in the Volkswagen Corporation, they have set a Newton meter of torque pressure here in the mechanism that it always closes. And there are some, for example, Mercedes customers that, you know, have problems with it. As soon as something is, you know, placed right here, the trunk automatically opens again. They say, that's too annoying. But then again, you can also argue Mercedes have obviously set another torque measurement that more goes in the safety direction. So for example, a Mercedes E-Class trunk, I could just put my finger in here, it closes, and it immediately opens again. And Volkswagen has set a different standard here. And of course, you can argue, is it better for a customer perspective that the trunk is always closing? Or do we rather go with safety? I always say, let's rather go with safety. And let's test it here. It's okay, it's okay. I think it's still a little bit too strong, just a little bit. But obviously, they have also learned and improved it a little bit. Yeah, you see here, I have to resist it, and I think a little bit too much. So it's still in the region where I can say okay, but I would advise them to be a little bit more sensitive with the torque measurement there. And this one is not only the full animal skin setup you can leave out, but also the 7-seater setup you can easily go for. And there we have this additional lever on the top side of the seats. Then we can use the sliding function of the seats to be able to easier access the rear part. And well, it is mainly not primarily used for big adults. Well, I do fit in here, but it's, you know, rather tricky. I can put off the head restraints. And that might be better in the Volkswagen Atlas, for example, because that one has even more, you know, about 30 centimeters of length. And then I can put the seat like this would work. And you can see here the difference between the seat that was far in the rear. So let's try very soon if I can still sit here in the front. But that would be a setup I could still sit in the rear. And headroom-wise, if I really lean back with 1.86 sit one, I exactly hit the ceiling. So, I mean, it would be okay for a short-term run. Seat belts are hidden here. And then there's a trick. You have to split them. Do it like this, and one goes left, the second one goes right, and then you have a full seat belt here also in the rear. So that's a clever and clean solution for sure. So I will get out on the other side because I want to leave the seat set up as it is and to crouch outside. So maybe best for the Mini Kicker soccer match. Those seats then don't have problems to get in and out. So, and I'll get around now because I want to know, can I still sit in the normal rear compartment while someone like me is sitting behind me? And now that's, well, just partly possible. So I think that would be okay. But then no one really huge behind me could sit. So if you have, let's say, 4 or 5 adults here in the front that are 180, 190 or 6'1", 6'2", then behind you, maybe there's space still for 170 in meters or, you know, 5'8", 5'9". That, I think, would still work. Overall, still, you know, I mean, good space offering, definitely. But for 7 tall adults, surely not. This is the seat set up here in the trunk with a 7-seater, and you can flip those down easily again. So like this, and then of course you can adjust the bench again. If it's a little bit more in the front, you can also easier access those. You can see there's also the split rear bench that you can, for example, just move one side more forward. So that's also possible. And then to move those seats up again, it's also quite easy. Just pull those straps here. There it is. And there you go again with the 7-seat setup. Here, by the way, there's another cover here hidden, because when you have the 7-seat setup, you probably won't put the trunk cover in, that you're always flexible. So let's take a look underneath the hoods. Engines, it starts with the 1.4-liter TSI turbo petrol engine, as we can already see it here. Starts with front wheel drive and manual gearbox, and only weighs 1,450 kilograms. That's not much for a compact SUV of that size here already. Then this one here, the variant, not with 125, but with 150 horsepower. This one can be combined with the automatic gearbox and also all-wheel drive. This is exactly the setup we have right here. Then there's the 2-liter TSI, also available with 180 horsepower. And maybe at the later stage, we'll also get the one with over 200 horsepower, as we can also see in Tiguan. Then there's a 2-liter TDI available with 150 or 190 horsepower. And I've talked to the engineers, maybe we can also get the bi-turbo from the Tiguan with 240 horsepower at some later stage. And also the later stage, this small petrol engine could be combined with a plug-in hybrid drive that will first be introduced with the Škoda Superb. And maybe then a year later with that one here, but that's maybe still 2 or 3 years ahead for sure. What else is interesting? Towing equipment with such an engine here, about 1.8 tons. And if you pick the TDI plus all-wheel drive plus a DSG, then you can also tow up to 2.5 tons. Let's start the driving part, and I'll first flash the ignition, because here it gives me the EPC and the engine warning light. And quite often we have the feedback from a Volkswagen, Skoda, Seat, Audi, whole Volkswagen Corporation: hey, it's a new car and the car is broken. No, it's not. When you just turn on the ignition, those EPC, the control flash, and also this engine symbol, that says me, the engine light, is working, basically. It's just a problem when it's flashing when the engine is on, like now. There, it disappears, and if it would then still appear, that would be a problem. But this is just, you know, a general remark, because we have that very often in the feedback. Let's go, and I want you to listen carefully, and I'll also test with another vehicle later on, but I was just starting the car and heard that one. It's almost like, you know, a half broken bed. And it's the same. There. I haven't experienced that in a Skoda car yet. And as promised, I will also test that later on with a different car. If it's just here about the single car, or if it's a general problem of the Kodiaq. And why do you feel or hear such things? Because, as I've told you earlier, the interior is that well processed that you get such a premium and high class feeling that if then something is somehow rattling or not that perfect, you do realize that immediately. And that's, of course, a problem for a manufacturer. I mean, that comes with becoming better and better and better, and you always have to remain at this level, also in the very detail. If you have a, let's say, rather cheap or budget car, which doesn't convince with premium quality, if it then would maybe rattle here and there, you would say, oh, you know, it's that car. But here, as we have such an impetus of, you know, that's basically maybe even an Audi build quality on the interior, then I also do realize those very small things that comes with it. And, well, those cars we're driving here are also very, very early models, and it happens from time to time in the tests that there are some minor mistakes still left, and there were a lot of examples for that. For example, let's say a new BMW 7 Series first car at the motor show, the gesture control didn't work 100%. Later, when we had the car, let's say three quarters of a year later, it worked perfectly, for example. Or maybe last time when we were on Majorca testing the new Ford S-Max, we had some plastics in the trunk which weren't covered yet, because this part was not available yet in the production process. So let's just hope it's really that. And I will also tell you later in the comments, when I tested some more vehicles here on location today, if we had the same rattling noise. However, the good thing is for you as a driver, if you will hear it, then just while parking, and also if you're not hearing any music, and if you're parking and get the steering wheel turned all the way to the end. And, you know, let's just hope you can live with that then. So, there's a lot to talk about, and so anxious to drive this car, basically. Looking forward really to drive this car. Because, you know, people were promising a lot about this car, of course, and people were expecting a lot. And how is it really? We will have different disciplines for our car here again today. We'll have the motorway here in Spain on Majorca. We have countryside roads with serpentine roads, good for the agility test, because this vehicle is also specced with the DCC. So we give you different, and well, we had the parking lot, we're turning the steering wheel already. So, I mean, the overview in general, steep window line in the rear. Also, you can see very well where the car is ending, but you do already feel it's a bigger SUV, yes. You don't sit that high than in some of the full-size SUVs. So, for example, it does feel bigger than a Volkswagen Tiguan, which is a direct sibling. But it's not feeling that huge, for example, than like a full-size SUV than the Audi Q7, for example. If you compare it directly with an Audi Q5, this one here feels lower. So you don't feel that much high seating position here. But I mean, still a good mix overall. From the driving feeling, it's also a little bit different because also the angles, how you sit and how the steering wheel is laid out, it's a little bit different indeed than the Volkswagen Tiguan, although a lot of things are the same, and especially if you're from one of the markets, for example, US, Canada, China, Russia, where you will have the Tiguan XL, if it will be called that way, with a longer wheelbase. Those ones here are very much the same, have the same wheelbase as well. Being on the motorway, also here at the moment a little rougher, now it gets, you also hear that. You hear the different changing road surface. So how is it about the sound insulation? Overall, we know it's basically good with Skoda. Sometimes we hear small nuances that the Volkswagen cars are maybe a little bit better insulated, but it's always hard to really feel it. So overall, I think a good result here. We have had cars that are more silent, but again, SUVs always stand in the wind, I would call it that way. So you always have to take that one into account. The car is really easy to handle, I can tell you that so far. Turning indicator sound, a classic one. Let's do some lane change here. Oh no. So we also have the blind spot monitor. See, there's those orange flashes in the side mirrors. There you see it, maybe. It's really bright today, but this was the orange flashing warning light. You could get that one optional. And that's really very important to get that one. I think it's one of the most important safety features to pick optionally. The front assist is already built in from standard equipment. That means that's the basic emergency brake and the basic city emergency brake. So that works up to a speed of 34 kilometers an hour. Then accident can really be prevented. And optionally, you can also get the pedestrian and cyclist recognition, which I also recommend you to go for. So blind spot monitor and the pedestrian recognition would be the two main things you should definitely get to, let's say, to extend the basis front assist, which I'm, you know, really convinced of, that it's good to have this one from a standard equipment. So we're driving the 1.4-liter TSI, the turbo petrol engine. Not in the very basic trim with 125 horsepower, that would be the standard engine, front wheel drive, and also just front wheel drive, so no all wheel drive, no rear. And also with the manual gearbox, that's the entry version to keep the price low. This one here, the 150 horsepower variant, is also available with the DSG. No, that's not so fast, the police. Policia. DSG and 4x4 is both connected here. You do not have to pick it, but you can pick it. Of course, it is a good thing because DSG, for lazy people like me, I'm lazy in shifting. Well, I'd say I'm not lazy in shifting in an executive way. I do shift a lot, so I don't just leave it in third gear or something. I know people also from our editorial office who do that. Greetings to Holger. But then again, I'm lazy as for I don't want to shift that often, so I'm really fine with the automatic gearbox. And 6 and 7 speed DSG are available depending on the engines you pick. You can say that the lower trims and the lower engines, they have, no, I think we have to go further. Those ones are connected with the 6 speed DSG, and the newer ones, the stronger ones, they are usually connected then with the 7-speed DSG. So, lane change, vehicle is still pretty agile, not tilting too much. So that works pretty well, and we're in the normal driving mode here at the moment. So I think the engine is very interesting because that could be a best-seller engine. It doesn't cost too much. It's one that is still relatively cheap. Not really the very entry engine, as I said. But you know, if you go for the 2-liter TDI, that vehicle can get really expensive. So this one could be so far my favorite engine, as also I'm always looking forward, also for your advice, for price performance ratio. And on the motorway here now, also overtaking, that was perfectly fine with the power. And let's see if the power will also be enough if we rather go to the countryside. That is also a crucial point. Sorry, going over some wide lines today sometimes, because I mean, I've been here quite a lot of times on Mallorca, but not always the same routes, obviously. But we're heading to a great landscape, I can promise you. Also, when going uphill now, it's nice performance from the engine. It's also very silent, the engine. You hardly hear the engine at all. And it doesn't take such a long time before a turbo sets in. The engine doesn't feel like it would be working so hard. It's really relaxed. And because some people wondered, with such a long car, 4 meter 70 or 15'5", is it enough for a 1.4 liter TSI? I'm usually also a fan of bigger displacements, because I don't think it's really fuel saving to tune a small engine to such high horsepower figures. But we can say that performance wise, it does work here with a 1.4 liter TSI with 150 horsepower. You can easily go for that one. The all-wheel drive, of course, if we are here now driving on dry road, I mean, we don't really need it. It's good to have it, but you know, you could also go without it. Test some handling here now on a plain road. Good performance from the steering wheel. It's really direct. You don't need much power to turn the steering wheel. And you can also adjust it from the DCC. So we will also test again the DCC when we're in those serpentine roads, because that will probably make more difference. But of course, want to have the Autobahn part in here, because this car will also be driven a lot on the Autobahn. And I can tell you, so far, it offers good comfort. Maybe let's even say great comfort. So I was expecting that, therefore it's not a surprise. And it feels just good to drive a real big SUV from Skoda, because we're so much used to a Superb or an Octavia. I've tested those so many times. So maybe some acceleration tests in the mid-speed regions, we can do that as well. For example, 60 to 90, and then you can also see the car shifting down just in the normal mode at the moment. Let's go now. That's what's 60 to 90. I can also scroll. Let's go to the driving data. Then you can also better see the speed in the digital form in front of us. And the sound from the engine was actually quite decent. Or what do you think? I mean, for such a small engine. Now in those roundabouts, you can already test the agility very well, and it is definitely still fun to drive the car. It does tilt a little bit more than, for example, a Seat Ateca or also the Tiguan, at least in the normal driving mode. But we can also change that. So we go to this mode switch. There it is, normal mode. And I do remember there were some of you guys who told me. Yeah, have to go through it. What about those driving modes? and how does it behave when? Eco, this is more for coasting and sailing. It means when I lift the throttle, the car is not decelerating that hard. The car is just rolling to save fuel. And also the throttle input is decreased. So having the car in comfort mode, steering wheel is very light to control, and the suspension is set on comfort. You can also go with a standard suspension, of course, DCC is optional. You will also be just fine with a standard suspension, I can tell you that. It will be no problem. But this one, of course, offers you more variety to change it. Normal would be really a standard setup, and then sport. Especially in combination with the DSG, the car shifts down earlier and up later. Maybe also hear that we are in a higher RPM region now. And that will also help us in acceleration. And also the steering wheel is a little bit stiffer. It's not a huge difference, just a little bit. So if we soon come also to a, wow, what a great landscape. We love the island of Majorca for its landscape, especially up in the north. Hear it also from the sound now. Steering wheel, yeah, it's indeed a little bit stiffer, and the suspension then is also sportier or stiffer. You can feel that you have more direct contact to the road. It's not again that it's feeling like a completely different car, but you do feel a difference, especially in the sport mode, that is noticeable. If I then hammer a throttle, for example, going 50 to 70, something like that. See, the car was already it, 75. The car did not have to shift down first. And if you sometimes feel that this 1.4-liter engine is not powerful enough, then here with those driving modes, you also have the chance to change the characteristics, of course, if you have the DCC. Then also the suspension setting is connected to that. So we will test that again when we are really closer to the countryside. We're getting closer and closer. And one of you guys was asking, if I go to the individual mode and then go to change, then I can, for example, have the steering wheel on normal, but the DCC on sport. So I have the steering wheel. Oh, that's the difference now, yeah. The steering wheel on a normal comfortable side, but the DCC is a little bit stiffer. Or I can also go for, let's say, DCC in a comfort, very comfortable suspension, but the steering on sport. So it's not happening here that you can say, oh, some sheep here, really cute in the olive groves. So now, for example, the steering wheel is on sport, it's a little bit stiffer, and the guy behind me is already wondering what kind of idiot is that in front of me. But I got the DCC on comfort, so you can really adjust that to your needs. And I was being asked which one is the best setup and how does it feel the best. And I don't really want to say this, oh, bird, this is the best or this is the worst setup. It really depends on what you like. For example, with a sporty steering, when you have it a little bit stiffer, it feels a little bit more natural because you have to work it a little bit more, like it was usual for a little bit older cars. And then again, if you say, I'm not that strong in my arms, you might just go for the soft steering. So you have the possibilities, and I think you can argue for every setup, basically. And I think this sport steering wheel feels more natural, but it might be not that handy when parking the car, for example. Other than that, you can also use the different normal setups, but usually you'll be fine in the normal driving mode. Now we're already getting closer to our fun countryside ride. It gets more beautiful and more beautiful. And I always like to show a process and evolvement also in our driving parts. Now again, changing from light to shadow, that's always interesting. And let's have some agile driving part here. Yes, changing from light to shadow is also not something about the design. Katrina, our camera woman for today, finds that really funny, and yes, she's right. So, let's give it a go. First in a normal driving mode, and I mean we are in a big family SUV, and is it still fun to drive? Yeah, it is, definitely. Now, when we're in those corners, the TSI gets sometimes a little bit weak. If, you know, a brake in the corners, then we have to go like this. Yeah, whoa, nice. It's relatively sporty even. Okay, I feel that the weight is pushing me a little bit to the side, but it's not that heavy. I mean, the basis version starts at about 1,450 kilograms with front-wheel drive and manual gearbox with the same engine here. Here, let's say all-wheel drive maybe adds 150 kilos. And then the automatic transmission maybe also 80 kilos. So this car could be about 200 kilograms heavier. Let's now go to the sport mode, if that's even more convincing. And in general, one of the things they have best figured out is the compromise between having enough sportiness and still enough comfort, especially as for suspension. I think that's a very important aspect. And also take the look here around our front camera. So beautiful here, the landscapes and the villages that are really aligned inside the hills. Very nice. Also, as the infotainment screen is aligned inside the dashboard. So now we're in the sport mode, get a little bit more contact to the road, also the steering wheel is stiffer. And it couldn't be more fitting that this very old truck just appears in front of my eyes. But maybe that's also a challenge, so I would say challenge accepted, to overtake him without harming us or others. Because on those serpentine roads, it can sometimes be a little bit tricky. But now you also feel and hear that in the sport mode, the TSI is also reacting faster. Mainly because we are always keeping it in the gear lower. You can also change this here with the shifting pedals. That's possible as well. And those give us the opportunity for situations like these, as soon as you see, you know, where you can do it, then you, this could be a chance right now here. Yeah? I remember driving this road also with the Audi TTS, not RS, with the Audi TTS convertible. You can also check that review out if you like this road here as well and want to see it one more time in a convertible. And maybe it would have been better to overtake this truck with the Audi TTS, definitely, but we will manage it here also with the Škoda Todek. So there's another car coming here. But maybe after that one, there's the next corner. Maybe that guy in the front here will. Oh, in Valdemossa here now. Also one of the famous cities here. Really beautiful spot. So now we're also getting to another speed bump. Let's see how the Kodiaq clears that with a stiff suspension. Easy going. So. Truck driver guy from Majorca, Spain. What about letting us pass through to test some of the sport mode? But let's go here in the normal mode once more and go over the same speed bump. Yeah, you do feel a difference, really. So I'm a little bit amazed by that. So I think if you compare it to earlier versions of the DCC, also in other cars, for example in Superb. Here they have made a bigger spread between the comfort and the sporty options, so you do feel more differences between those adjustments. It's really interesting to see. Let's go for it now. So, that's cleared. And even for that, you can do that with the 1.4 liter TSI engine. And also again, the sound was really nice. So I think this engine could really be a good advice, price performance, and you don't have to always hammer the turbo. if you need it, it's there, and then you also have enough power. Next challenge, a Fiat Panda. What is better, having a Fiat Panda in front of us or an old Mitsubishi Fuso truck? We'll also clear that. But I mean, that's just traffic light, traffic life. And you have to handle that as well. And with a Skoda Kodiaq, at least, you can say you can always also remain quite calm because it's a very comfortable car. And no, don't turn right, everyone. Well, we'll catch you. Yeah, come on. I mean, is that the police over there? Maybe I won't overtake right now. Let's check out if that's the police. What do you say, guys? Do you always already see it in the front camera? Some guys at the side of the road, and she in front of me is also driving slowly. So really relaxing ride when driving it in a slow pace, and with the DCC you can really play around. I mean, I will usually leave it in a normal driving mode. No, it's not the police. There are some cyclists in taking some photos. Well, from distance, cyclists taking photos can also look like police. That happened. So, that's a normal city again, and shows also the versatility of that car. Sport mode. And the sport mode you need to overtake a white Fiat Panda. There we go. 42. 80, 90. Yeah, you can see the performance here again. And I think what is really a crucial thing is that I'm really talking about performance and riding agility in a rather big SUV already. And that shows you that this SUV is really fun to drive, although it's among the biggest in the compact SUV segment. You know, as it derives from that platform. Yeah, the Volkswagen Atlas is even longer, okay. But still, it derives from a compact vehicle platform and therefore is still considered to be a compact SUV. But it's really fun to drive, and I wouldn't have expected it. So it's sportier than expected, especially if you have the DCC. So my verdict to the DCC is, you will surely be fine with the normal suspension if you want to save money. However, if you're living in regions with a lot of serpentine roads, as you can enjoy with us right now, and you want to have some sporty fun, then you should go for the DCC, that you can adjust that. Of course, it gets a little bit more uncomfortable when the road is bumpy. Meanwhile, I mean, you have to live with that. But overall, I mean, I would have expected, for example, okay, maybe the Seat Ateca is the sportiest of those MQB SUV siblings from the Volkswagen Corporation. But this one really feels sporty as well. Very nice. How is it for my co-driver? It's okay, still comfortable? Because that's also a good sign. If the co-driver has been, you know, totally tilting around, then you know also that maybe the suspension is not handling it that well. It's always so always talk to your co-drivers and ask them, do they still feel comfortable? And if they maybe start puking, that's maybe not a good sign. So what about, let's say, let's go in a comfort mode but still in those serpentine roads. Will that get uncomfortable? Is it too soft or is it okay? I mean, I feel when I'm not in the sport mode, I need to shift down myself maybe sometimes, because here 60-70 kilometers an hour and I'm in fifth gear, so sometimes would have to shift down. Yeah, the suspension is a little bit softer. That's on the one hand more comfortable if you drive slower. If you really want to push the issue, then of course it's more fun to drive in the sport mode. It's really interesting to feel when you're in the sport mode, you have the sound a little bit, lower gears, a little bit stiffer suspension. It has also an effect on how you drive. when I'm in a sport, I think, oh wait, I'm in a quite sporty car. Let's hammer it a little bit more. Let's drive a little bit faster. Now here in the comfort mode, I think, oh, you know, well, what's the matter of driving fast? Let's drive comfortably and just relax and enjoy landscape, nature. Probably a more reasonable choice. And really interesting how those driving modes can not only be your choice from your mood, also the other way back. So have an impact on your mood again, how you feel like driving. So you can play around with that. The steering wheel again, I didn't like it that much in the Škoda Superb. I have the feeling it's a little bit more progressive here. That means I don't need such a long steering angle. So no matter if I have it in a rather soft or in harder mode set up, I don't need much steering angle, and that's one thing I like best from those recent new products, also from Škoda, Audi, Volkswagen, Seat, that they have this progressive steering. They have figured out that very well. You see, when you have the combination of all-wheel drive and also the steering wheel, you never have to take the hands off the steering wheel, and that's also a big safety aspect. The DSG is shifting perfectly, really smooth transitions, hardly feel it shifting. I think Katarina is not that much comfortable with the comfort mode. Obviously, the sport mode is better for the co-driver. Also, an interesting finding here today. So much fun to drive the vehicle. It's really sporty, especially if you like to, and you don't feel that you're moving 15 foot 5 or 4 meters 70. I think that really speaks for the car. So, wow, nice ocean. Mediterranean Sea, it's not an ocean, it's a sea. I mean, it's definition. So I could also keep on driving here for days and keep on talking about this car for days, especially in connection to this landscape. Maybe you can enjoy some more corners here with me. And I think this driving part conveys it very well, that it's a fun to drive car and also good in, let's say, every aspect: suspension, driving fun, agility, steering. So I think in the very beginning with this squeaking steering wheel, that was coming back to the driving conclusion here. When a vehicle is really that perfect, we can really see it. Something is, let's say, 90, not 100%, you immediately realize it, and you wouldn't maybe realize it if it's not that 100% perfect. So I'll check it out again with another vehicle if we have that squeaking sound there as well. That would be very interesting. But I mean, I just heard it on the parking lot, so even if that would be built in with every vehicle, it's a thing they have to work on, that it happens with no vehicle. But even if it would be a feature in the Skoda Kodiaq, I mean, I would still take the car even if that mistake is built in here. Maybe one last remark to the infotainment screen while driving, because it's a little bit lying flat in there. It's also a little bit protected against sunlight and reflections. That's good. It is mainly touch-based, but you can also use those knobs while driving, because touch screen while driving, you always, you know, shake a little bit while driving. Then you can also zoom in and out with knobs, or also use the volume button. That's also fine, so you can do that as well. And the display is very crystal clear, at least when you have freshly cleaned it with a microfiber tissue. So maybe I should have one of those in the car to keep that one clean, then it looks really great. You can see it very well as well. The gauges, the center one, they are rather classic. But as I've told you earlier, we'll also receive some news about that one very soon, when also the Škoda Kodiaq will receive the full digital instruments. So I hope you liked our countryside riding here also today, and our impressions from the Kodiaq. I hope we could clear all of your questions so far, also as for the driving part. Hey Thomas, can you also take us for a stroll with the entry level engine? Because I want to save money and just buy the weakest engine. I don't need more. Manual gearbox and front-wheel drive. Sure, I can. Let's do it. We see the Lava Blue 1.4 liter TSI, 150 horsepower in front of us. We're passing it now, and we are here now in the white one, also 1.4 liter TSI. Did I say 1.5? Just 1.4 liter TSI with 125 horsepower. Really tricky corner here. So, and let's see what we get as an acceleration and the overall driving feeling. And what I already realized in a static position, I can prove shifting is really a lot of fun because it's so smooth to put in the different gears. So even, you know, I'm not a fan exactly of manual shifting, but still, I mean, that's perfectly fine. Also, here, by the way, manual seating position, controlling it while driving, it's not as comfortable as with the electric ones. I mean, you can still do it in a static way then. Oh, we got some flies that are accompanying us. The flies are, by the way, very attractive to the white car, not to the blue one. Very interesting, definitely. So we got a straight road here at the moment. We can also show you some of the acceleration. For example, if we go from, let's say, 30 now to, let's see, 30 to 50 in the second gear. Plop, that's it. So I think if you primarily spend your time with city driving or countryside, you'll be perfectly fine also with the lowest engine setup. Of course, it's not really suitable for towing. And I mean on the Autobahn, when you then want to do some accelerating maneuvers or overtaking on the motorway, there you might lack some power. Here, for example, also now in a little bit higher speed regions, let's go, let's say, 60 to 80. Let's go now, 70, 80. I mean, that's not the biggest power, but still, it's really okay. So, just if you want to have some very fast motorway rides, you should maybe go for the higher engine. But it's also my task, you know, not to sell you the highest trim level versions of the cars. I want to advise you also how to get the best price performance deal. And this one here definitely works, it's no question. So if you want to really leave it with the entry price of the Kodiaq, that's perfectly fine. So that's also what I said with the basic interior package. Even if you get the basis Kodiaq, you already get a very good car, and then of course even have a better price performance deal for sure. Sixth gear, by the way, is just let the car roll, save some fuel. And with the 1.4 liter TSI with 150 horsepower, the official consumption is something above 7 liters, but the effective one was about 10 for sure. You can even get a little bit higher than that. I mean, that won't make such a difference how much horsepower you have in this variant. Here with that one, with front wheel drive and with the manual gearbox, the consumption will be lower because automatic transmission and also, let's do it, turning by the way here, just for a turning circle. So automatic gearbox and also the all-wheel drive, they take, they give you more consumption because they give you more weight here, by the way. It's really easy to turn the car around, and as you also have the light steering. So although it's pretty long, I was also doing some stuff yesterday, for example, to turn on the middle of the road in safe spots, and that was easily possible, especially with the rear view camera. So really a cozy feeling here. Fast here in the corner, good support from the car. So it's really amazing again how sporty the car, relatively sporty it already feels. And also again here in the basis version. And the slalom, not too much tilting. You can get a driving modes here. It's not not that much available here because we don't have the all-wheel drive, but I can go for the sport driving mode again. Won't have such an effect here as we're not in a DSG car, so if you have the manual car, the driving modes don't make such a difference because you control the gear shifting yourself. So, I mean, in a DSG car shifts down earlier and shifts up later, but here you do it yourself anyway, so maybe then also, not sure, you can also save money and don't get the DCC, for example. So, again, a pleasure to enjoy it also in the entry version. And so everyone that is going to higher speeds at Autobahn, maybe motorways, not the ideal solution. For everyone else, you'll be just fine with that one for sure. And then it's really possible to go for the entry codec here, as we see it also with fabric seats. We only have the big infotainment screen mounted. That is one of the most expensive options this car here is equipped to. And now we are joined by Thomas Hukasz, so a double Thomas set up here right now. And here is the product manager for the Skoda Kodiaq. And he can surely tell us what was the main challenge when developing this car.
We as brand Skoda have been producing our cars since 1895. And we always put a very strong emphasis to put and come with the technical solutions, making the life of our customers very easy. And the time has changed and our competition is changing as well. And especially all the world around us is changing very significantly and rapidly. Therefore, the main task was to bring up or to come up with a car, making or combining all the traditional values of our brand together with highly sophisticated digital solutions, in which our car would be not just a supplementary element, but a fully integrated part of this world.
So you're also making the price list, for example, and it has been, you know, very complicated in the configurator and all the different trim levels and so many options to pick for. So maybe if you would also configure your own car, maybe not a full spec, but, you know, a reasonable spec, what are the most important things that customers should look out for? What shouldn't you miss in the option list?
Where every single Skoda car and the Skoda Kodiaq as well is full of simply clever solution. We are famous for all over the world. Of course, with the new Skoda Kodiaq, we are bringing to market and for especially to our customers completely new simple clever solutions, as for example, so-called door edge protection. We are especially proud of this system because it's completely patented. So protected by the copyright, and in addition to this, well, people are also thinking, well, why should I take some complicated or sophisticated system? Because in the future, I will be really worried about the service maintaining of the sun. So we have been thinking about this as well. Therefore, we have come up with completely mechanical solution. So there is no electronic stuff or electronic device behind in the door or in the mechanic in general. Therefore, we are pretty sure that even in the long term, in everyday usage, even when very small and not always polite children sitting in the rear will be, let's say, handling with the car very roughly, we really trust in our car and in terms of long-term reliability.
Does it come with every Kodiaq or is it also an option, the door protection?
Well, in something between, because this system you can pick up in the configurator, but actually already from the second equipment level, even in Germany or in France, every day worldwide, you get this system as a standard in your car.
So starting from Ambition, is it then?
Exactly.
And maybe another option you would especially, for example, advise to families to go for?
So one of these options would be definitely electric child look. It means you are not anymore obliged to lock the rear doors manually, but instead of this, on your control panel of the windows in the door, there are two additional buttons you can additionally press, and therefore automatically your doors are locked in terms of mechanism, in terms of controlling of windows as well. Another good feature maybe would be so-called in-car communication. It means internal sound amplifier, which much more makes internal communication between you as a maybe parents and your children in the rear seats much funnier and much better and more efficient.
So maybe if there's you know, a revolution on the rear seats, then you're still able to speak up.
Definitely.
Thanks for the insight.
Anytime.
And now to our conclusion for today, the all-new Škoda Kodiaq. So which one would you go for? Which color? Lava blue, or here the moon white car? Or we've also shown you different other colors. What do you think about the exterior design? I think overall a rather conservative exterior design and doesn't want to attract too much attention. I think overall it will work. It also basically fits to the Škoda design philosophy to be rather elegant, not to create too much attention. The interior, from a very high build quality, would just, we know, was one minor mistake with the steering wheel, but that might also be just due to the pre-series production, so the pre-production cars we tested quite early. I also tested it with another vehicle later on. You get this little squeaking sound at the steering wheel at the very wide angles. Let's hope they fix it also for the very final vehicles. But other than that, really a great high-class build quality. You can say it is a build quality that is in the premium segment, and you might really wonder if you take a very reasonable approach when you say, why should I pay double the price for an Audi? You can argue with that, because this one here starting with 25,000 euros, well, more, rather this one here with the front wheel drive and with the manual transmission, this is really one of the best price performance deals. So for sure, in the compact SUV segment, this one is one of the best cars you can buy for that. We can easily say that. Especially the biggest factor was the space we have on the interior, on all of the seats. Even more flexible if you go for the manual seat setup, as we've seen here in the white car on the inside with the fabric seats. You'll be just fine with the basis setup also with the fabric seats. Optionally, you can also pick those, as I said, fabric on the inside and leather red on the outside. So a lot of good options we have here, and you do not have to go for the highest trim level to already get a very good car on the inside. Some basic functions like the front assist already in there. I would surely go maybe for a nice infotainment system, and then those front assist build-ups with the pedestrian recognition, and I mean maybe an automatic gearbox, but you don't really need it. But already, like, for 35,000 euros, you can get almost a totally dream-specced car with so much space, and that's hardly ever achievable on the market. And might also be an argument to pick this one and not the Volkswagen Tiguan, because that one is also a little bit more expensive. Although, me myself, I do prefer the Tiguan, for example, a little bit more from the exterior. But that's, for example, also just personal taste. Driving this car, it is surprisingly agile. So although it's one of the longest in those MQB SUV setup, it is still amazingly agile, especially if you have also the DCC option spec'd with the sport driving mode. So that was one of the big surprises there. Everything else totally smooth on the ride, very comfortable. So there was nothing to be found to be criticized there. So overall, as I said, at the moment, alongside surely also with the Octavia and the Superb, which are also a great price performance deal, it's no wonder that Škoda is meanwhile among the most important importers also in Germany, where, you know, have a hard competition against the very strong companies from Germany that are also producing inside the country. And also worldwide, China has become the biggest market now, even ahead of Germany. And who knows, maybe they will also at some point enter the US market. But so far you get the Volkswagen Atlas there then, and also the Tiguan with a long wheelbase to be introduced there soon. Thank you very much for watching this episode here with Autogefühl. I hope we could clear all of your questions you had in advance, and we covered a lot of different aspects and elements here today. Looking forward to your feedback again, and I'm really sure you will also join us at our very next episode. Thanks.